official app workstation. North Shore 104.9 WBOQ Gloucester.
The following paid program does not represent the views of North Shore 104.9. Welcome to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial. This morning during the program, your host, Marc Freedman, may discuss specific financial planning and investment ideas. These discussions are for general information only and are not intended to provide specific advice or recommendations. Financial planning and investment advice is offered through Freedman Financial, an SEC-registered investment advisor located in Peabody, Massachusetts. Securities are offered through LPL Financial, a member of FINRA and SIPC. Freedman Financial is a separate entity from LPL Financial. Investing involves risk, including loss of principal. Always consult a certified financial planner professional, qualified attorney, or tax advisor prior to investing to determine what is appropriate for you. Listeners to this radio show should consider the investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of the investment company carefully before investing. The prospectus contains this and other information about the mutual fund, variable annuity, and variable annuity subaccounts. To obtain a prospectus, you may contact Freedman Financial or your financial advisor. Prospectuses should be read carefully before making a potential investment. And now, here's the host of Dollars and Cents, Marc Freedman of Freedman Financial.
Good morning and welcome to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9. My name is Marc Freedman. I'm president and CEO of Freedman Financial, located in Peabody, Massachusetts. Well, usually located in Peabody, Massachusetts. We will be back to the office soon. We are right across the street from the soon-to-be-slowly-opening North Shore Mall. I understand they're going to start opening the doors there next week and beginning to allow some additional curbside delivery and of product. And you might have access to a few of the stores in there. And I am just above Alto Forno Restaurant, which I can't wait to have reopen. And hopefully that is coming soon as well. I am broadcasting once again live from my home in North Andover. This is week, I think, 10 for us, and probably week coming into double digits for many of you, either working from home or getting used to having the kids at home without being at school. It's gotten to be a little challenging, hasn't it? It's we got into this little routine, and now it's getting a little bit more challenging, especially when you turn on the TV or you check your social media feed, and it's getting kind of polarizing as to what people think they should do about addressing this challenge that we have with COVID-19. Should we listen to the scientists? Should we listen to the words of the economy? Should we consider all of the mental health issues that could fall from this? Who should we listen to? And then as we begin to take an opinion, the information changes on an hourly or daily basis. Some people are questioning what they should be doing, or maybe the governor wants to adapt and make additional adjustments to what we need to do, even in our own state right here in Massachusetts. It's been challenging. And then you see what might be happening in Georgia or Texas or Michigan or Nevada or Washington State. And every state has different rules, different guidelines for maybe just the city. Maybe it's for a county. It's very strange. And what we believe is needed for us may not be as necessary for other places. How do we handle this? And this pandemic is not just in the United States. The pandemic spreads even further, and it goes into China, and it goes into Brazil, and into Russia, and into Ecuador, or wherever else you might think. All around the country, everybody's impacted, and everybody shares their story, their news, or frankly, their propaganda. Who do you want to believe? What source is the right place to get the information that is actually true and reliable? The answer is none of it, really, because the rules keep changing. Even the smartest of the doctors out there, starting with the czar of COVID-19, Dr. Fauci, even backstepping a little bit, saying, you know, we need to get out there. We can't live at home forever. We don't know when a vaccine is going to come about. And just being honest, I think what we're being challenged with is we want definitive answers from our leadership. We want to have answers so we know what to do. And unfortunately, they really don't know. But they want to try to give us hope. They want to give us optimism. But they also want to give us care and wisdom so that we can be smart, each of us individually. But by relying on this is what Fauci said, this is what Governor Baker said, this is what Trump said, this is what whomever said, and believing that that is the path that we need to follow for between now and the end of the year, forget it, folks. Those rules are going to change. We need to each personally take our own set of responsibilities and say, how are we going to protect ourselves and our family and stop being so damn judgy about every other person that walks the streets, that hops on a bike, that rides in a car, that sits in a park, that goes to the beach, that opens a shop. We got to stop that, folks. That is not healthy for your mental health or anybody else's. We got to take care of ourselves. What you think you're doing as the best approach to approaching the challenges that we have here with COVID-19, that's what you need to do. If you want to quarantine yourself to your home 100% of the time, hire DoorDash or Postmates or whomever it is to deliver your groceries, great. But the person that goes to the grocery store or goes to the nursery or goes for a walk around the neighborhood, don't shame them. And if they happen to be with another friend who happens to be walking with them, whether they're wearing a mask or not, you don't know whether they've been living together, whether they've been cohabitating, whatever it is, don't shame them. Just take care of yourself. This is really starting to get extraordinarily polarizing. It's getting political, and it's very, very frustrating. We need to work together, not work further apart. And if each one of us step up and say, what am I doing for myself that I think is right for my family? That's what you need to do at this point. Sure, restaurants have opened up in New Hampshire, and it seems someone was reporting to me that there were more Massachusetts license plates at restaurants in New Hampshire than there were New Hampshire license plates at these restaurants in New Hampshire. We've got to come together and figure out how we're going to get through this. And you know what? This pandemic has not been with us for years, folks. It's been with us. You know, some will say, well, the first case was back in December or January. Sure, that may be the case. But this thing really started up in March and April, May now, and soon to be in June. It's been a few months. And for us to think what we've gone through over the past 3 months, a real crisis when we started, and now we're starting to see the curve certainly flatten. Sure, we can be concerned about some tick-ups along the way, but we certainly have this far under control. There is certainly no shortage of respirators. There is certainly plenty of hospital beds if needed. Not that we want that numbers to that to tick up, but everybody is taking personal responsibility. I believe we are going to get through this faster than we might think. And the re-entry into America, into the economy, into just being active participants in this country is going to happen at a pace faster than you might be surprised at how fast this pace happens, but I think we'll do it at a level that is far more responsible. Sure, there are going to be pictures. Look, everybody remembers the pictures that they've seen of folks on the steps of the city hall in Detroit, Michigan, and the state house in Michigan, of people without wearing masks and some of them holding guns around their neck with American flags wrapped themselves around. They said, you can't take these liberties away from us. You know what? Though there are rallies like that that happen in America every day. They happened last year, they happened last week, and they will happen in the years to come. The challenge is, though, is that the news stations that share this information elect to share those pictures rather than the fact that planes are landing safely at Logan Airport, the fact that we are celebrating the good news, celebrating the fact that we have managed to figure out how to handle graduations, how to handle the reentry of things in America safely. No one wants to share that. Everybody wants to share the tragic stories, the stuff that can just be just to drive you nuts. Well, remember this. When you see that on the news, are they reporting news or are they reporting a form of entertainment? Folks, that's what the news is all about these days. It's about entertainment, because how does the news get paid? You might think, Marc, you're being ridiculous here. But the truth is if you're not being extreme in your picture showing, in your storytelling, advertisers won't drop into your news show. They won't advertise on a variety of different places. That's how advertising works, folks. That's how media makes money. They have to be extreme. I think I've told the story for a number of years long ago. I used to appear in one of those faces on CNBC, and there was a station called CNN-FN that I was on a lot back then. But as the market started to tumble back in 2008 and 2009, and we went through this financial crisis, they would call me and they say, Marc, we need you on the show today to join one of our hosts. And my face would go up there. And they'd say, so what do you think the market's going to do today? And I'd say, honestly, I have no idea. What do you mean you have no idea? I said, the truth is, it doesn't matter. What the market does today, tomorrow, next week, or even a month from now, the people we work with are long-term investors. They're not speculators. Our clients are worried about what's going to happen 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years down the road so that they can continue to have the income that they need, the resources that they have, that they need to support their lifestyle. And I'd get off the air and the producer would get on the phone. They say, Marc, we need you to, you know, give a more impassioned story about right now. I said, but I don't know what's happening right now. We'll make something up. Be extreme. And I'm like, are you kidding me? That's what they want. They want me to tell you on the news, I think the market's going to drop 40%. Or I think the market's going to soar 20% today. Or I think oil prices are going in this direction, or lodging prices are going in that direction. I'm not going to do that, because that's inappropriate. But that's what people want. People want sound bites. They want information right now. And so what we've been doing at Freedman Financial is we've been hosting a series of video town halls for all of our clients. We've done 10 consecutive weeks every Thursday at 4 o'clock. And I want to open it up to the listeners here of Dollars and Cents to say, if you would like to be a part of our video town hall, don't worry, your face doesn't show up on the screen or anything like that. You just get to tune into a 30-minute show that Mary and my business partner and I put together to talk about relevant issues of the week and things that you might want to be thinking about, as you're stuck at home and thinking about your personal financial planning needs. You are welcome to join our video town hall, but I need to send you a link to do it. So if you'd like it, go to my website, freedmanfinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, financial.com. Go to the bottom of any page on my website. You'll basically be signing up for my newsletter. But if you've already signed up for the newsletter, just put something in the comment section. You put in your email address, your name, and then in the comment section say, hey, I'd like an invite to the video town hall. That's it. No one's going to solicit you, nothing like that. You're just going to get the invite. And you're welcome to join us. We have over 100 people every single Thursday that are joining us for this video town hall. I think you'll really like it. So what I'd like to do today, when we get back from our break, I want to share some of the questions and answers that we delivered last Thursday, because they are relevant today. They are going to be relevant for the next, hopefully, weeks and maybe a month or two. And ultimately, we start to unwind ourselves out of this and start to get back to a new normal. We're going to take a quick break. When we get back, more stories for you and what I call financial advice in a language you can understand. You're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9. Marc Freedman, president of Freedman Financial and host of Dollars and Cents, heard here every Sunday morning from 8 to 9 a.m. Each week, I try to provide listeners with financial advice in a language you can understand. And much of my advice comes from real-life situations that happens in my office, Freedman Financial, each and every day. You see, at Freedman Financial, we help individuals and families create smart strategies for spending money in retirement. Our approach is committed to placing your interests first. And best of all, Freedman Financial is independent, and we're a fee-based financial planning and investment management firm. We're absolutely committed to helping you get your financial house in order. When you're ready to get serious about your financial planning needs, give us a call at 978-531-8108. That's 978-531-8108, or on the web at freedmanfinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, financial.com.
Securities offered through LPL Financial, member FINRA, SIPC. Investment advice offered through Freedman Financial, a registered investment advisor and separate entity from LPL Financial.
Stay home. Stay home. No reason in the world for you to run.
I don't know about you, but I'm sick of staying home. But we have to endure. We have to do what we have to do. The governor is starting to set a reopening plan here in Massachusetts. If you're listening from other states around the country, perhaps your governor has set different opening standards. I'm not familiar with how all of the states are working, but we are familiar with what's going on here in Massachusetts. My name is Marc Freedman. I'm president and CEO of Freedman Financial, located in Peabody, Massachusetts, where we provide financial planning and investment management advice to individuals and families who live on the North Shore, the Merrimack Valley, and the Southern New Hampshire area. We have roughly 450 households that we have served, that we serve today. My father started our firm back in 1968. So, of course, there's a rolling in and rolling out of some clients because generations happen and some people die, some people move, things change. But we have been very fortunate. People ask me, Marc, you know, how busy has it been at the office? It's been crazy. I will tell you, we have the greatest clients in the world. One of the reasons is that we have structured our business with our clients with them understanding that we are not speculators. We are going to build investment portfolios that align with their goals and objectives that fit a much larger financial planning picture, such that when things like this pandemic, when things like a financial crisis happen, we are not going to radically change the structure of your portfolio. We are going to hang tight. We might do a little tweaking here and there, but we are going to continue to give you guidance. We're going to continue to communicate. We communicate on a regular basis with all of our clients. We have a newsletter that goes out every Friday at 10:30 in the morning. It's been going out since March of 2009. Think about that, 11 years, every single Friday with a newsletter landing in your mailbox that we write. We don't buy it from outside sources. If you'd like to get our newsletter, go to my website, freedmanfinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, financial.com. Go to the bottom of any page, put in your name, your email address, and we'll get you signed up for the newsletter. It's that simple. Also, another thing that we've been doing for the past 10 weeks to keep our clients in the loop is host a video town hall each and every Thursday at 4 o'clock. If you'd like to receive, if you'd like to participate or even listen to our video town hall, we do not post them after we do them. We show them live, and that's it. So if you'd like to get an invitation to listen in to our video town halls, send me an email, Marc, M-A-R-C, at freedmanfinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, financial.com. Or if you happen to sign up for our newsletter and say, I'd like to also be invited to the video town hall, just put that in the comment box. We'll take care of it for you. We've been having regularly at least 100 people tuning into our video town hall. So it's been great. People keep coming back because we're providing some financial advice in a language people can understand. We have got some opinions, of course, but I'm not going to try to sensationalize some of the news and the stories that you are hearing, whether it's on TV, through your Facebook feeds, through whatever you read. I mean, everybody's got an opinion today, and it's getting extraordinarily polarizing. We try to make sense of it all and offer some thoughts that we think are relevant to you. So what I thought I would do in this segment today, and in this second segment, is share some of the questions that were posed to us prior to our last Thursday's call and give you some thoughts and answers. So, like I said, we do this video town hall every Thursday, 4 o'clock. If you'd like an invitation to the video town hall, drop me an email, Marc, M-A-R-C, at freedmanfinancial.com, and we will get you an invite. So the first question that was asked of us was, Marc and Marion, Marion's my business partner, what do you and Marion think about Governor Baker's plan for reopening Massachusetts? And I try to look at this from a bigger perspective. One of the hardest jobs that people do not give enough credit for is the responsibility and the guidance that a person in charge, especially in a large operation, needs to handle. And whether you're the CEO of a company, big or small, whether you're the president of your local, whether volunteer president at a local community organization, maybe it's your church, maybe it's your temple, maybe it's a not-for-profit organization, the chairperson of or the commissioner of the softball league in town, whether you're the governor or whether you're the president, your job is to understand, is try to listen as intently as you can and carefully as you can to all of the opinions and all of the perspectives that people have at the current time, and then work with your team to come up with a set of guidelines that you think is fair for most people. Because you have to know that you will never, ever satisfy everybody. And that's the problem. That's what Governor Baker is facing. That's what the president is facing. That's what Dr. Fauci faces. That's what the CEO of every company in America faces. You have to know that when you're making big decisions, you're basing those decisions based on the information that you have at hand. You have to assume and hope that the information that you have is accurate. And in many cases, you have to realize that that information, like now, could change at a moment's notice. And you have to be ready to pivot. That's the big term that's out there right now. Are we pivoting appropriately? Some will agree, some will disagree. But here's something that I was sharing with somebody last night that I thought was interesting. When you are a company and you set a standard, whether the rules are to do one thing or another, doesn't matter whether you're a manufacturing firm, whether you're an entertainment firm, or whether you're, doesn't matter. Let's say you're in charge of doing the big dig in Boston, a project that was set and took many, many years to develop. Someone had to figure out at one point, at some point when the big dig started, how many people, yes, believe this, how many people would die on the job during the big dig? Huh? People think about that? Well, yeah. As much as we want to have a successful project, and as much as we want to build this project within budget, we have to know that there are going to be instances where people will become disabled, where people will die because of a work-related injury. And we have to figure out how much insurance should we be carrying for that. Yeah, people think about that. So understand this. When the president or the governor or whomever it is rolls out a plan, they're not rolling out a plan figuring that there's going to be a 100% buy-in and success rate. They have to ask themselves, with the team and the support mechanism that's with them, how many people are we going to satisfy, whether it's through our stimulus package, whether it's through our unemployment plan, whether it's through reopening of Massachusetts? If we could get 85% of our population, I'm just grabbing that as a number, if we could get 85% of our population to be satisfied and 15% to be miserable, is that considered success? Now, if you're a small business owner, 85% satisfaction is not good for you. You want everybody to be satisfied. You want to do everything you possibly can to satisfy as many people and maybe get a 98% satisfaction record. But when you're having to deal with 300 million people in America, or 5 million people here in Massachusetts, or 15 or 50,000 employees when you're a corporation, you know that there is going to be a sliver of your population that will never be satisfied with the answer. And sometimes you realize some of them, even with the decision you make, you know they're going to be upset. That's what we have to live with. There are many people right now that are frustrated with the unemployment benefits that some people are getting, that they're getting paid 2, 3, 4, and 5 times more what they were making when they were working. Did the government, when they rolled out this plan, did they know? Did they know what this COVID-19 situation was going to look like in April, May, June, July? No, they were going based on the information that they had. And they wanted to make sure that Americans had the resources available so that they could pay their basic bills. But as it relates to the reopening plan here in Massachusetts, Governor Baker is trying to be strategic. He's trying to be thoughtful, knowing full well he'll never please anybody. I remember when I was the president of the Peabody Chamber of Commerce back in 2000. In 2000, Mayor Terigian, Peter Terigian, was was the mayor in charge at the time. And I sat down with Peter and I said, "Peter, what kind of advice can you give me? You know this city better than anybody. You've been doing this a long time." And he said to me, "Marc, one of the biggest challenges of being in charge, you know, there's a lot of people that like to rally around, hold up signs, protest, yell and scream, be part of the problem, but they don't want to offer up the solution. They don't want to be the person that's going to fight for the solution. They want to offer the problem." And so he says, "When you're the mayor, you are basically the biggest baker in town." Yeah, I said baker. He says, "Because you're baking a pie, and your pie is representative of your town's budget, of your business's budget, of the budget that you have. You say, here is the amount of money that the board of directors, that my administration has said, I can spend money. Here is my pie. Yet there's a lot of people that want a piece of that pie. And what you have to ask yourself is, how do I provide the best resources to the largest number of people by splitting this pie in as many pieces as I can, knowing full well many people will be disappointed that the sliver of pie is not enough. And some people will actually get left out and not get any pie. That's the challenge that the mayor faces, that our president faces, that Congress faces, that CEOs of organizations face. Frankly, it's some of the decisions that you and I face as we begin to think about how do we re-enter back into America. What risks do we want to take? What risks do we think are smart risks? And which ones are dangerous? I mean, some will feel like they can walk around the supermarket without a mask on, without fear of anything, bump into people, ask employees for help, and not worry about it. Others will walk in with masks, gloves, and a hazmat suit and feel like they're not protected enough. The governor sets a set of guidelines. Then stores set their sets of guidelines. And what we have to do is meet those minimum standards. For instance, the governor this week indicated that religious institutions, churches, mosques, temples, can open to parishioners at a 40% capacity with a variety of different types of safety standards, the distancing, the positioning in pews, and all sorts of stuff in these locations. Yet many religious institutions, despite the fact that they are allowed to open, have said, no thanks, we'd prefer not to. In fact, many places are finding that the online, the Zoom technology that they have structured to continue to provide worship for their members has been so successful, they're having, in some cases, 10 times as many people attend virtual services than they are in-person services. So that's what we have to decide as a business owner, is just because the governor said we can open or said your organization can open, do you want to and can you do it safely? That's one of the questions that's been asked of us. Another one that was asked talked about, I'm hearing that people don't want to go back to work because they're collecting more in unemployment benefits than they would if they returned to work. This doesn't seem right. And I'm reading a question that was sent to us for our video town hall this past Thursday. Now I hear that Congress wants a phase four stimulus plan that will allow the unemployed to continue collecting the extra $600 a week check through the end of the year. How can our economy recover if people aren't returning to work? Folks, that is the big dilemma right now. It is frustrating when people are getting paid more to stay at home, when on the other side, the administration, our governors, our states are saying, let's go back to work slowly. And let's say you're working at a retail shop and you're allowed to do curbside delivery or whatever it might be that you can have in your shop. And the work that you do when you come back is going to be more of a maintenance person than it is a sales clerk. Do you want to go back to your job with a different set of job responsibilities and not be certain that you're going to collect as much money? Yeah, maybe you'll get the same paycheck, but if you were doing sales, perhaps your business was based on commissions. Or maybe you were making more money just being at home than you were going back to work. And now you're hearing your employer tell you, well, if you don't go back to work, when the job is available for you, you may not be able to collect unemployment benefits. That's scary. And so people don't know what to do. And then with this question of, what if Congress extends the $600 a week? Why would I even want to go back to work? I might like to take my summer off and enjoy it by the pool. You see, the $600 extra week check that employees are receiving through unemployment benefits is going to end at the end of July. My guess is that is ending in July. There is no way Congress is going to support providing an extra $600 a week to unemployed individuals over and above their unemployment check through the end of the year. That's no way that's going to happen. I believe that if Congress is smart, they do a couple things. Number one, pay people a little bit less. Not give them the $600. Incentivize their business owners to incentivize them to come back to work. Don't extend the full unemployment benefits. But, you know, there's more to talk about, and I'm running out of time. I'm hearing the music in my ears. So let me continue that thought a little bit more thoughtfully. We're going to take a quick break. When we're back, you're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9.
Where to go, weed in and spread the virus, because we were all at home just playing on a phone.
Hi, this is Marc Freedman of Freedman Financial. For more than 50 years, we've been providing individuals and families on the North Shore and Merrimack Valley with financial advice in a language you can understand. As each of us struggle to find answers in this uncertain environment, we're continuing to communicate with our clients in a variety of ways. Our weekly newsletter, our video town hall, our client teleconferences, and periodic phone calls continue to offer ways to address clients' questions despite remaining physically distant. If you're feeling alone and searching for rational advice during these emotional times, perhaps Freedman Financial can provide the comfort that you need. Give us a call at 978-531-8108. That's 978-531-8108. Or visit us at freedmanfinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, financial.com. Freedman Financial, financial advice in a language you can understand.
Securities offered through LPL Financial, member FINRA, SIPC. Investment advice offered through Freedman Financial, a registered investment advisor and separate entity from LPL Financial.
Well, that's changing, isn't it? Governor Baker's opening up the doors. Sounds like we're going to start getting back to work in the next few weeks, maybe a couple months. But phase one has started. Phase two continues, hopefully, in a couple weeks. And we will start to move back to work. And I hope you are all looking forward to getting back to work as much as so many other people are. Yeah, I've continued to work. We have not taken a day off. In fact, I think I work harder from my home than I do from the office. Just the nature of the business. But it's been good. My name is Marc Freedman. You're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9. We do this show each and every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. right here on North Shore 104.9. We are I run a financial planning and investment management firm out of Peabody, Massachusetts. Our office is located just above Alto Forno Restaurant, hoping that opens up real soon. And we're right across the street from the North Shore Mall, which is starting to slowly open up as well. We offer financial planning and investment management advice to individuals and families who live on the North Shore, the Merrimack Valley, and the Southern New Hampshire area. We are a comprehensive financial planning firm, meaning, yeah, we manage a lot of money. $450 million we're managing, actually. Yet, we also provide financial advice to all of our clients. Who are our clients? Who do they represent? Perhaps you know somebody who's a client of ours. Perhaps you're looking to make a change or you want a second opinion on your financial plan or even your investment portfolio. Well, we're going to look at it all. Our typical clients are married and they're over the age of 50. So believe it or not, they've been living in their same home for 20 years or more. They've grown up here on the North Shore, the Merrimack Valley, the Southern New Hampshire area. They've held middle to upper middle management jobs. Generally, their income while they've been working is somewhere between household income, probably somewhere between $100,000 and $300,000. Their total net worth, when they add up the entire value of what they have in their bank accounts, 401k plans, the value of their house, everything, is probably somewhere between $1 million and $3 million. Now, when I say $1 million and $3 million, what's your house worth? I mean, perhaps your house is worth $500,000, $700,000, $800,000. Well, you're not going to take that money from your house and probably turn it into an income stream. You got to live somewhere. So you got to use the resources that you've accumulated over the years or hope to accumulate over those years to provide an income stream to you. So that income stream from the investment assets, maybe your 401k, your investment accounts, money in the bank, et cetera, that money has to provide an income stream to you, along with perhaps a Social Security check, a pension check that you might get. Maybe you're going to receive an inheritance, whatever it might be. 65% of our clients are retired. That means they are relying on income from their resources to support their living expenses on a month-to-month basis. So we are professionals at making sure that you're squeezing money from your investment accounts in the smartest possible way so that you manage taxes, you get the money that you need, and you're doing it so that it stretches through your lifetime. I don't know how long you're going to live. You don't know how long you're going to live. But as much as you may not want to hear it, chances are you're going to live a lot longer than you ever imagined. Strong likelihood you're going to live well into your 90s and perhaps over 100. Yeah, that's going to happen. And you need to make sure that your money is invested. I want to address that question, to how we do that, in a minute. But I do want to go back to a question that I left people hanging with in the last segment. I was sharing some of the questions that are asked to us during our video town hall that we run every Thursday at 4 o'clock. If you're a listener to this show, I'd invite you to join us on our video town hall. However, it is invitation only and it requires a password. So if you'd like to receive our video town hall invites, all I ask you to do is drop me an email, Marc, M-A-R-C, at freedmanfinancial.com, and I will happily send you the invitation to our video town halls. Or you can sign up for our newsletter that comes out every Friday at 10:30. All you need to do is go to our website, freedmanfinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, financial.com. Go to the bottom of any page, put in your name, your email address, and in the comment section, just type in, hey, could you send me an invitation to the video town hall, and I will do that as well. So we're here to help. So this question that was asked, and I think this is the question that many families are wrestling with right now. The question that was asked to us was, I'm hearing that people don't want to go back to work because they're collecting more in unemployment benefits than they would if they returned to work. To me, this doesn't seem right. And now I hear that Congress wants a phase four stimulus plan that will allow the unemployed to continue collecting the $600 a week check through the end of the year. How can our economy recover if people aren't returning to work? And I think that's, you know, that's the billion-dollar question here. Was Congress smart in creating this $600 extra incentive check back in April for unemployment benefits? Was this the smart thing to do? You know, at the time, we didn't have nearly as much information as we have today. But the thought was, in building this plan, was we were going to give stimulus check money, $1,200 per individual, or $2,400 per couple, plus the extra $500 per child, based as long as you met the income requirements. Send them that, and plus this unemployment income, this extra check, if you were furloughed, if you were laid off. The whole idea was so that you had money coming into your house to cover your basic expenses, not all of your expenses, your basic expenses, because this virus, this pandemic, is not your fault. This didn't come because of you. It came from some outside source, and it's impacted the world. So how do you have enough money? And so what's rather interesting with this $600 check is between the $600 extra check, the unemployment benefits that are being collected, the stimulus money, people are actually finding, the average person is finding that they have more income than they had when they were working. And when you have more income and you don't have anything to spend it on, your bank account's getting a little bit bigger. And that's rather interesting. And because of that, the stock market, as you well know, which dropped 35% back on March 23rd, is now, the S&P year to date, is down only 8.5%. Maybe since the high, maybe 10 or 11%. And that's because there is tremendous optimism that people are being responsible with. They're not going, some businesses will. Some, you're itching to get out and just shop. Just to, as those in my tribe say, to just schmy around a little bit. Just to walk through a place and shop a little bit. We want to get out. We want to spend money. We want to go out to eat. We want to re-engage in the community. And that money is all being pent up in a lot of cash, sitting in a lot of bank accounts. But should this continue? Should this continue, especially for, look, my son tells me of a few of his friends who were working part-time. And the business that they were working at closed. And so these kids decided to apply for unemployment benefits. They were making $200, $220 a week. And they went and applied for unemployment benefits, and they're collecting. Now get this, they were making let's just say $200 a week. They're getting an unemployment check for $100 a week plus $600. My daughter, who has friends that had internships at college, their businesses were shut down. They were making $200 or $300 a week. They're getting a check for half of that for unemployment, plus $600. There are people that are working full-time 40 hours a week, making $12.75 an hour. And maybe they're making, I don't know, maybe they get a check for $400 a week or $500 a week. Normally, they'd get a check for $250 plus $600. All of these folks, and these are essential people. These are the people that are the engine of what happens in America. And businesses want to open, and we need those people to come back to work. And they're saying, huh, I don't want to come back to work. I'm making more money just sitting at home. My son's friends say, why would I get a summer job? And even though this check that they'll continue to get will end right now in July, they said between now and July, I'll make more money between now and July through unemployment than I would have had the whole summer had I been working. I might as well take the month of August off. Yet, we're talking about people we know, and there are others that struggle, and everyone has a different situation. But should that $600 a week check continue through another phased-in stimulus plan through the end of the year? In my opinion, it is absolutely not. Couple things. Number one, I think it's going to be a struggle for many small businesses to open, especially restaurants, especially people in the service industry. How about a massage? You want to go get a massage? Who wants to touch someone who's getting a massage right now? A chiropractor, different people that are going to have, you know, hands-on stuff. All these service industries, these people are going to be slow to come back. But we need people to come back and help reinvent these businesses. And I think Congress needs to figure out a way to incentivize the small business owner, entice them with some, hazard pay is the wrong word, but some incentive checks to come back to work for a period of time so that they can have the confidence that they can make money successfully and also be contributors to the success of the business. We need to figure this out. But paying people two, three, and four times what they were making on unemployment is inappropriate, frankly. I mean, you want to max it out with the 100% of what you were making before? That's fine. If you were making $500 a week and unemployment was going to pay you $250, and your pandemic unemployment check should be not $600, another $250. So it's the same. Or maybe just 80% of it. I don't know what the number is. But I think the small business owners are really struggling through this. And we need to do what we can, and Congress needs to do what we can, to get these small business owners confident that their employees will come back to work. I think that's critically important. All right, I want to jump to another question that was asked of us recently. He says, you know, Mark, I know the market has rebounded from its lows, but why are some of my investments still down a lot more? And the point that this person was trying to bring up was many of us, those of you who have worked with a financial advisor, those of you who have taken guidance from online financial tools, I don't care whether it's Susie Orman, it doesn't really matter. You've known that in order to build a proper portfolio, you need to consider what's called asset allocation. Asset allocation. You want to be able to spread your money out over what are called different asset classes. Large companies, small companies, mid-sized companies, value companies, growth companies, bonds, stocks, all of that. You need to have a little bit of everything. And we've done that successfully. And for years, people said this has worked out well. It's taken out some of the giant spikes up, taken away some of the giant spikes down, and has closed the gap a little bit. But what's interesting is despite the fact that you hear that the S&P 500 isn't down all that much right now for the year and even from its high, down about, you know, 8, 10% or so, many people's portfolios that were money in stock funds, money in bond funds are down as much and sometimes even more than what the S&P 500 is doing. And here's the reason why. Did you know that there you can buy what are called dividend paying stocks and you can buy growth companies? Dividend-paying stocks generally fall into a category called value investments. There's other types of growth investments which take the profits of their company and reinvest it back into the company to create new and improved products and updates. Now, many people have said, Mark, you know, with interest rates at zero in the bank, with bonds paying next to nothing, where should I put my money? And the sense is, well, if I'm going to invest in the stock market, which might feel a little shaky and a little challenging, I'll definitely invest in stocks, blue chip companies, the biggest companies in America that pay a dividend. Might make sense. And I think it's appropriate to put some of your money there. But there has been this desire to put more money into these into the dividend paying stocks than growth stocks. Well, here's the problem. Dividend paying stocks are down significantly more than are the largest of growth stocks. Here's something that might be shocking for you. If you looked at all of the big company growth stocks, the Amazons, the Googles, the Microsofts, the Pepsi Colas, the Disneys, the Teslas of the world, that index, the large cap growth index year to date, is up 3.32%. The large cap value index, which is made up of all of your dividend paying stocks, maybe they're banks, maybe they're companies like Caterpillar, maybe they're utility companies, maybe they're energy companies. Did you know that the large cap value index is down 18.8%? So large cap value down 18.8, large cap growth up 3.32 as of the 20th of May of 2020. That puts, you put them together, and now the S&P 500 ends up being down around 8.5% or so. You got a little bit of both. But some people just want to buy all growth, or some people want to buy all value. What's the best way to approach this? How do we manage a portfolio in an average, in a period of time when different asset classes are doing better than others? Well, I've got an answer for that. And I want to share that with you and some more financial advice in a language you can understand when we get back. You're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9.
Rely on the old man's money. It's a bitch, girl, but it's gone too far, because you know it don't matter anyway. Say money, money won't get you too far, get you too far.
What if you could blend the classic strategies of investing with a contemporary approach to financial planning? That's what Freedman Financial can do for you. Wherever you are along your financial journey, Freedman Financial has the skills, technology, and experience to help you make smart financial decisions. Their team of certified financial planners will deliver an independent, objective, personalized plan for you. Freedman Financial. Financial advice in a language you can understand.
Securities offered through LPL Financial. Member FINRA, SIPC. Investment advice offered through Freedman Financial, a registered investment advisor and separate entity from LPL Financial.
Shut it down, lock your doors. It's cancel culture, getting bored. Nothing left for us to do but sit at home and watch the news. We didn't spread the virus.
Welcome back to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9. My name is Marc Freedman. I'm president and CEO of Freedman Financial. Hope you're having a wonderful Sunday morning, up nice and early, having your coffee. And hey, I got some good news here. I've talked to you about a good friend of mine, and probably many of you, actually, if you're from the North Shore, our friend Karen Nesenbeni, who is, you know, to me, the face of the North Shore. She appears everywhere at every Chamber of Commerce event, every social event, and she's also the general manager of the theater at the North Shore Music Theater. As many of you may know, she has struggled with COVID-19 for a number of months, actually, more than 60 days, actually. And she had been on a respirator for a very, very long period of time. And this past week, yeah, great news. She was released from the hospital. And so Karen is back home, and I couldn't be more happy for her. She's got a tough road ahead of her and a lot of challenges to deal with. But my heart is warm just because she is home. And I know so many of you are celebrating that Karen is home as well. So Karen, for me, welcome back. We've missed you, and I can't wait to see you again. Anyhow, I wanted to continue this conversation about investing, because during this period of time, many people are wondering, did I make the smartest move? Should I be chasing some opportunities? Because if you listen to the president and you listen to some of these economists, they're all saying, once this pandemic starts to slow itself down a little bit, with all the money that's been funneled and fed into the hands of Americans, we're going to take off like a rocket ship. And I do believe that's going to happen. I really do. It may not happen as quickly as the president would like it to happen. Some industries will rocket very quickly forward. Others are going to lag behind, probably those in the travel and the lodging industry. I mean, how comfortable are you hopping on a plane I don't care if it's a plane to Washington, D.C. or the Caribbean, and you can't go to Europe or anywhere else right now. So you're not about to start hopping on planes for leisure travel. I also think that business travel is going to be a little bit different in the years to come. I think the days of one-day business trips are going to be a long time before they start to recover. I don't say they're over, but I think it's going to be a long time for them to recover. You know, hotels, however, are starting to see what we call green shoots. The opportunities of people going back to hotels, airlines are starting to see little pickups. You were seeing single-digit visitation rates to single-digit occupancy rates at hospitals and numbers that were, you know, we saw 9%, 10% of what traditional travel through airports looked like compared to a year ago. Well, we're starting to see movement forward. The lodging industry is starting to report, you know, occupancy rates now in the teens. Nothing exciting here, but it's moving forward. Airlines are starting to see an uptick in people buying tickets and traveling. So that's a nice sign. Folks, if you saw how cheap airline tickets were for a while, if you still think those cheap airline tickets are going to be around for a lot longer, I caution you and tell you that's not going to happen. If you want to start booking trips and start thinking proactively about traveling in maybe October, November, December, whatever it might be, you might want to start buying those tickets because the price is going up. And the way the airlines are structuring things, by the way, they're giving very, very liberal opportunities for you to cancel your flights, make changes to your flights without any costs at all. So you might want to consider looking at that. But I do want to talk about this investing thing because a lot of folks are saying, well, maybe I should be buying individual stocks since it seems like the growth side, the technology companies, they are soaring. But my dividend paying stocks or dividend paying funds, Marc, they're not delivering much of anything at all. Well, remember, you are still getting a dividend from your dividend paying stocks and funds. And they have probably a lot more to gain and grow. And remember, when you fall into the value category, if your stock has been decimated or hurt, you also fall into the value category. You probably have a lot more upside than do growth companies. Think about this. Let me share something. I think I might have shared this last week actually as well. So we've all heard of Zoom technology. Many of you are using it. And we have gone from in 2019, December of 2019, there were 10 million people using Zoom. In March of 2020, that grew to 200 million people using Zoom communications. In April of 2020, that number jumped to 300 million people using Zoom technology. Now, if you take the number of people that own shares of Zoom, and everyone say, oh, I got to buy Zoom. Look, it's just going to soar. This is going to take over the world. It's going to be great. The shares of Zoom have certainly gone up. But if you take a look at what the value is of all of those shares, you see, when you buy a share of stock, you, along with perhaps millions of other people, own shares of that stock. And you take the share that you have and multiply it times the price of the share, and you see what your value is. You add up everybody's shares, and now you have what's called the market capitalization of the company. What is the company worth based upon its stock price? Well, Zoom communication, based upon its stock price and the number of shares that are outstanding, is roughly $50 billion. That's what Zoom communications is worth, $50 billion. And, you know, $50 billion, do we even have an understanding of what does $50 billion really even mean? Well, let me try to put what $50 billion is in perspective. So ask yourself this. If you wanted to make an investment for the next, let's say, a five-year long-term investment, would you feel comfortable investing in Zoom technology with what you think they might have for an upside potential? Or would you feel more comfortable in the upside potential of all of these companies? Southwest Airlines, Delta Airlines, United Airlines, Lufthansa, American Airlines, Air France, and a group called International Airlines Group, which consists of Emirates and Qantas and all of those. All of those airlines, you add them all up right now. Did you know that their collective value is $46 billion based upon their depressed stock price? All of those airlines together are worth less than Zoom communications. So if you're a thoughtful investor and you're thinking, I want to invest for the long term, Do you think the long-term opportunity is something like Zoom communications or in the airlines? Now, I'm not telling you to be speculative here. I don't want you to be buying for the day, for the week, for the month, even for the year. But as we begin to thoughtfully look at how we build client portfolios and how portfolio managers look to structure mutual funds for our clients, I think they're looking at what is extraordinarily overvalued, yet is on the top of mind and the tongues of every person who wants to invest. I can't tell you how many people will call us and say, what do you think of Zoom? What do you think of Amazon, Walmart? And how about the stock Moderna, this pharmaceutical company that perhaps might be having some success in its trials? Folks, that's why I don't want you investing in individual stocks. That's why we don't buy individual stocks for our clients. I want to let the professionals who do this on a 24/7 basis build portfolios through mutual funds that provide our clients with the appropriate growth so that you can survive through periods of time like this and also through periods of time when it's really great. Because we know that our clients, those who we serve, who are approaching retirement or who are in retirement, and they are scared and wondering, what happens when my paycheck stops? How will I continue to be able to provide an income to myself, to my family, to support our expenses? How will we manage it through these challenging times? How will I stay rational during these emotional times? Well, I will tell you, you don't do that by buying individual stocks and speculating. You do that by building a portfolio that is well allocated, that includes areas of the market that are doing well, as well as areas of the market that aren't doing so well, because we know all of those areas are cyclical. And collectively, by having some winners and some losers, and doing something that's called rebalancing, believe it or not, taking some of the profits from things that have done well and buying at a cheaper price something that hasn't done so well, building a portfolio that is built to last for the long term, to give you the income you need. If now is the time for you to get serious about your financial planning, if you're getting a little worried about what your retirement might look like, if you want a second opinion, if you want to sit down with somebody who says, who's willing to offer financial advice in a language you can understand, let us talk to you. Give us a call. Our phone number at the office is 978-531-8108. That's 978-531-8108. No, we're not meeting in our office. We are still staying away from the office, though we could go there. We are working individually from our homes, but we can do Zoom calls with you. I can have a phone call with you. I can do a Google Meetup or a Facebook Live or whatever you want to do so that we can get to know you, explain how we work, learn more about your situation, and we can even do some work, you know, electronically. And when the time is right, when it is safe to reopen the doors and welcome you back in and welcome all of our clients back in, we will be there to provide you the financial advice in a language you can understand that's personalized, customized, and far from cookie cutter. You deserve that. Retirement can last 20, 30 plus years. And we want to make sure that you have the resources that you need, the income that you deserve, and the stories and the strategies in place so that you can deliver success to both you and to your family for decades, decades to come. That's what we do at Freedman Financial. If you'd like to sign up for our free weekly newsletter, go to our website, freedmanfinancial.com. That's Freedman, two E's and a D, financial.com. Go to any page, put in your name, your email address, and a comment to us. And if you'd like to visit and be part of our video town halls that run every Thursday at 8 a.m., I'm sorry, at 4 p.m., drop me an email, Marc, M-A-R-C, at freedmanfinancial.com. That's going to do it for us today. I got to make room for Scott Whitley, who is on day, 800 of doing consecutive food shows. What a great job he's doing keeping the restaurant business alive. The best to all of you. I will see you again next Sunday. You're listening to Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial on North Shore 104.9.
Thanks for tuning into Dollars and Cents with Freedman Financial. During the show, specific investments may have been discussed. These discussions are for general information only and are not intended to provide specific advice or recommendations. Please consult a certified financial planner, tax professional, or attorney to determine what is appropriate for you. Consider your investment objectives, risks, charges, and expenses of an investment company before investing. That's because investing involves risk, including a loss of principal. A prospectus contains this and other information about
mutual funds, variable annuities, and variable annuity sub-accounts. Prospectuses should be read carefully before making an investment. Securities are offered through LPL Financial, member FINRA and SIPC. Investment and financial planning advice is offered through Marc's firm, Freedman Financial, which is a registered investment advisor and a separate entity from LPL. Thanks again for tuning in. See you next Sunday at 8 a.m.
The prior show was a paid program that does not express the views, opinions, or beliefs of North Shore 104.9, the station management, its employees, or staff.